Is anybody here with any Irish in them? Is there any of the girls that like a little more Irish in them?
Thin Lizzy were the ultimate boyzone rock band. Some say the best ever to come out of Ireland. Don't
believe me if I tell you. Great song, great guitar playing. Every modern rock band has a little bit of Thin Lizzy in them.
They inspired average people to think, well, if you can do it, so can I.
Throughout the 70s, they produced hit after hit. Their distinctive vocals and twin guitars lending a whole new sound to hard rock. At their heart was lead singer Philip Lynott, writer of some of rock's greatest anthems.
He brought a vivid intelligence to this thing that could be just dismissed as adolescent boys' music.
The shapes, the look, the style, you know, the point, and he had the crowd in the palm of his hand.
But with these talents and the success that followed came legendary rock and roll behavior.
I did get into a lot of fights.
It was the roller coaster ride, you know. Is it gonna stay on track or is it gonna fly off the rail?
There was always kind of shit happening, if you like.
The least professional band in the business.
This is the story of a band that from small beginnings went on to conquer the world through raw talent, hard work, and a little bit of Irish luck. It's early 2010, and on a Tuesday morning at Dublin Airport, one man stands out among the hordes of tourists and business travellers. Almost 30 years after Ireland's first rock supergroup split, Thin Lizzy's ex-guitarist Scott Gorham is back where it all began, on a mission to breathe new life into their music.
We've been talking about this for years, actually taking the original recordings of the albums that we did, the earlier albums, and to go into the studio and put kind of a remix on these things. Just be cool to hear Phil's voice in a really nice produced atmosphere.
Scott's on his way to the home studio of Def Leppard lead singer Joe Elliott.
Joe, baby!
Good. He'll be working with ex-Thin Lizzy drummer Brian Downey to bring these tracks back to life.
Hello, looking right to left.
They're starting with the legendary Jailbreak, the sixth of 14 albums they released in their career.
From under my breath. Well, I count to three, blast them.
Gosh, why didn't we use that?
Seems like it was yesterday, really. That's a pretty distinctive voice, talking, singing, anything, you know. When you were around it as much as Brian and I were, it just seems like it was like you should be walking through the door, you know. Tonight there's gonna be a jailbreak. If that happened, I think I'd go right through the plate glass window.
Straight out.
Words I wrote and play and sing for you. The seeds of Ireland's first commercially successful rock band were sown on the streets of a tough neighbourhood in 1960s Dublin. It was here where 16-year-old Philip Paris Lynott got his first gig, singing in a neighbourhood covers band. Brian Downey was an ex-pipe band drummer who lived just around the corner from the singer.
He was in a band called the Black Eagles, and he used to actually go and see him playing in Dublin. He was a great singer. He was a brilliant frontman. He had great presence on stage. I said to him one day, and I said, look, you know, the band is really great. He said, what do you do? And I said, I play drums. He said, come down next week and you can play support with us. So I was with him for about maybe 2.5 years. Black Eagles was a bit of a laugh, you know, with Phil and the guys, you know, but the band broke up. We kind of lost contact for a bit.
After short stints apart playing with other musicians, Phil and Brian got together once more to form a band called Orphanage. One of the first people to see them play was Eric Bell, a blues-loving guitarist from north of the border who'd once played with Van Morrison.
I went to this club one night with this keyboard player. The band came on to play, and it was a band called Orphanage, and Phil Lynott was the singer, and Brian Downey was the drummer. It just blew me away, you know. And they took a break during the night. I started talking to them, and I said, yeah, I could fit my guitar playing into your song style. And Philip says, hey, Brian, do you fancy forming a group with Eric? And he said to Brian, I want to play the bass, and I also want to do some of my own songs. So I said, yeah, OK, let's give it a go.
Up to now, my youthful state.
In 1969, the new band started gigging Phil's compositions of folk rock with a Celtic twist. All they needed now was a name.
Eric Bell thought of the name. There was a comic called The Beano, you know The Beano? And on a John Mayall album cover, Eric Clapton was reading The Beano, so Eric Bell was a big Eric Clapton fan at the time, so he went out, and when we were looking for a name of the band, he bought a copy of The Beano, and there was a female robot called Tin Lizzy. Well, T-I-N-L-I-Z-Z-I-E. And he said, we should call the band Thin Lizzy. I thought it was a dreadful name, honestly. What does this mean, you know? And so we made it Thin Lizzy because Dubliners say right. Tin anyway, you know? So it was just about as deep as that, you know?
The new band started to look for gigs. But unlike Britain, where clubs, rock concerts, and even music festivals were everywhere, the Irish scene was still years behind.
Strangers in the night, exchanging glances, wandering in the night.
Ireland was a very backward place at that point in time, you know, especially in the country. The show bands ruled the roost. It was usually 8 people, a brass section, keyboards, guy at the front, singing. Well, they would do the top 20 that was in the charts at that particular time, and they would also do evergreen songs like Danny Boy. One of the first gigs we did, there was an Irish show band on before us, and there was about 600 people there, very country people. So the show band finished and we walked on, and they just laughed, basically, and started pointing up at us. Look at him, look at him. Seriously. They never seen nothing like it in their life. I thought it was like a UFO had landed outside.
Look what the wind just blew.
Bill was always a very striking figure because he was tall and thin and basically a good-looking guy, very unusual. He was the only black guy of his age group in there were very few black people in Ireland at that stage, certainly around Dublin, a few students at Trinity, and that was it.
I think he always saw himself as being some sort of an artisan. You know, he did hang out with poets. He did go to poetry sessions. And I basically think that he knew he was different, but he was going to make that difference work for him.
Look what the wind just blew in.
It didn't take the three-piece with the black singer long to make a name for itself on the Dublin club circuit. But what they needed more than anything was a record deal.
I was going to Ireland anyway with an in-house producer. We were going to look at a singer, actually, called Ditch Cassidy. Ditch was very good, but there was a three-piece band behind him. And I must admit, I was watching more than Ditch Cassidy. Great drummer, fabulous guitar player. And Phil, a black Irishman, never seen before. He was so thin, you could have knitted with him, you know, he was lovely. The deal was, they would have to come and work and live in England. There was no point in signing a band who were going to stay in Ireland. That was no good to us, because any record sales, you know, wouldn't cover their boat fare.
Thin Lizzy landed in Britain in 1971, as glam rock bands like Slade were breaking into the charts, alongside established acts like David Bowie and The Who. They recorded two albums in quick succession, but neither made much impact. If they were going to have a hit, the three-piece from Dublin would need some Irish luck.
Thin Lizzy used to rehearse in this pub in King's Cross, I think it was, upstairs. And we used to rehearse there every week if we weren't playing. And sometimes it just wouldn't happen. On this particular day, we were having a hard time. So Philip anyway picked up a guitar and he started going down. You know, he's just messing about with these Irish songs. And about 20 minutes later, he started going.
His eyes is going over the Cork and Kerry mountains.
And Phil Branamy's sitting there going, you know. At that point, one of our managers came in, Ted Carroll.
I said, I think if you can go in the studio and record it just like you played it now, you've got a hit.
And we said, don't be stupid, you know. We left Ireland to get away from that type of music, and now you want us to record it. So me and Philip went out with two acoustic guitars. Bran got on the drums, and we went like...
In 1973, Whiskey in the Jar won them their first Top of the Pops appearance, reaching number six in the UK charts. Thin Lizzy had a hit single on their hands.
It still was very much Thin Lizzy. I mean, Phil's vocal, the rhythm, the whole feel of it was great, and it established them.
I think that Phil, when he appeared in his first Top of the Pops, his whole life changed instantly. A whole new vista opened up to him because he looked out, there was all these fantastic looking women. A whole new world opened up. I'm not too sure about Eric. I think it was a bit overwhelming for him. She swore that she loved it. Never would she leave me. It got us loads and loads of gigs. We were going out to places like Germany, Finland, Holland, Spain, and we're actually going out to these places to play Whiskey in the Jar, but we weren't playing it. We were just miming it, you know, on TV shows. And you know, everybody was getting kind of, you know, fed up with this, you know, especially Eric Bell.
He was really just fed up with the whole, like, star trip, you know. Eric just wanted to play the guitar and get on with the music.
I started going on stage pretty out of my head. And not bothering to practice anymore. I don't even think I tuned up the guitar anymore before I went on, because the band was no longer Thin Lizzy. We were playing on stage in Belfast, and this little voice within my head said, throw the